Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Thank you very much to the hymn choir. And good morning. It's good to see you today. Would you please bow your heads and join your hearts with mine in a word of prayer? Most gracious and loving God, high and heavenly Father, we pray that you would lead us now to your truth, and in that truth, set us free. Amen. So here we are at the beginning of August, but think back with me to 1 month ago, the beginning of July. For me, it was right after vacation Bible school, when all week long, my colleagues and I were surrounded by 150 kids. So I, for one, was looking forward to a little less excitement in my life. But then came a surprise. My wife and I got a phone call from our adoption agency. April and I had wanted to adopt a child, and we had worked to adopt a child, and now we were simply waiting to adopt a child. And we weren't sure when it would happen, or even if it would happen at all. But then we got this call. The social worker on the other end of the line said, "Justin, April, a young woman has come to us and she's pregnant. She's from Middle Tennessee, 19 years old, a college student, and she's in some trouble and doesn't think that she can parent the child. And so she's made a plan, an adoption plan, and she wants to meet with you because she may choose to place the child in your family." Well, after getting over our initial shock and surprise, one of the first questions that we asked is, "When is the baby due?" "In 3 weeks," the social worker said. Well, my wife and I, we gasped and we gulped and we said, "3 weeks? Can we receive a baby into our home in 3 weeks? Can we receive a baby into our family in 3 weeks? Is that enough time to get ready for a child? Can you ever be fully ready for a child?" Of course, no. Well, on Monday, July 13th, we met face to face with the biological mother, also known as the birth mother. Sitting down for lunch were five of us, the birth mother and April and myself and two social workers from the adoption agency. And we sat and we talked and we got to know each other. And by the end of that meeting, we sensed a nice connection among us all. And so when April and I left that lunch, we thought, well, maybe, just maybe, this might work. Well, 2 days later, on Wednesday, July 15th, I was here with many of you at the Gospel Sing-Along, and we were singing and eating and having a good time, and when it was all over, I got in my car and I drove home. But as soon as I walked in the door of my house, my wife was shooing me out the door of the house because, surprise again, the adoption agency had called. The birth mother was going into labor. A week early. So we got into our car and we drove to the hospital. And when we got there, we went straight to the room where the birth mother was. And when we walked in, there was no one there except the social worker and the birth mother. No husband, no boyfriend, no fiance, which gives you a sense of the situation that she and the baby were in. No family support. The birth mother asked us to stay with her in that delivery room. Now remember that April and I had just met her 2 days before. And remember that childbirth is one of the most intimate of all experiences. But we were glad to stay there with her. And we were with her through every contraction. We held her hands as she breathed and pushed. And hearing the baby's heartbeat on the monitor was one of the most awesome things that I have ever heard. I don't think I'll ever forget the sound of that. And lo and behold, late that night on Wednesday, July 15th, a baby boy was born. We named him Isaiah Kennedy Gung. Well, 2 days later, on Friday, July 17th, Isaiah came home to be with me and April and our two dogs. You can't forget the dogs. Well, I still marvel at the timing of it all. We only had 3 weeks' notice that a baby was on the way. The baby was born a week early, so it ended up being only 2 weeks' notice. We had only met the birth mother 2 days before she gave birth. There is no time at all to arrange a nursery in our home. There is no time at all to have a baby shower. In the eyes of the world, the timing must have been so off. But with the eyes of faith, the timing was just right. It was perfect timing because it was God's timing. Adoption can make for a beautiful story, can't it? We all saw this a few years ago with the movie The Blind Side. First a book and then a movie. The Blind Side was nominated for Best Picture at the Academy Awards. Sandra Bullock was nominated for Best Actress, which she won. But for her work in the film, she received so much more than a golden statue. She received a son. After acting out adoption on camera, she didn't want to just act anymore. After experiencing adoption on the silver screen, she didn't want the fairy tale to end. And so she decided to adopt a child, a boy named Louis, who is now 5 years old. So many other folks, well-known and unknown, rich and poor, near and far, have firsthand experience with adoption. And as I look out on the congregation, I know that many of you can say that adoption is a part of your family history. Some of you have a child who was adopted. Some of you have a grandchild who was adopted. Some of you were adopted yourselves. Adoption is a beautiful way to create a family. You know it, and Sandra Bullock knows it, and I know it, and the one who knows it best of all, is God. God has made adoption an important part of his family plan. He's creating a family, the family of God, which is wide and varied and colorful and diverse, and adoption is an important part of that plan. God's family plan includes adoption, and this is evident when we read God's family history. Of course, I'm talking about this book right here, the Bible. God's family history is recorded here, and adoption stories are woven all throughout it. It's there in black and white, plain for all to see. Don't believe me? Well, let's just take a look. And why don't we start in the Old Testament? Have you guys ever heard of Moses? Of course you have. Moses is one of the great patriarchs of the nation of Israel. God put his words in the mouth of Moses. God put his law in the hands of Moses. God put his people under the leadership of Moses. If Israel had a Mount Rushmore, Moses' face would surely be on it. Well, Moses' story begins in the book of Exodus. And in the book of Exodus, the Hebrew people are in a desperate plight because Pharaoh has enslaved them. And he treats them cruelly and ruthlessly and violently. At one point, he even orders the killing of babies, all of the male Hebrew babies. Well, Moses is a male Hebrew baby, and so he's endangered. So his mother places him in a basket and nestles that basket among the reeds in the Nile River. Well, along comes none other than Pharaoh's daughter, who sees the basket, and she plucks it from the water, and she looks inside and discovers the baby, and then what does she do? She adopts him. She has compassion on him. She accepts him. She claims him. She cares for him and brings him into her home and raises him as a member of her family, the royal family of Egypt. And because of that adoption, Moses' life is saved. And because of that adoption, the people of Israel are saved. Saved from slavery in Egypt and delivered into the promised land. Adoption, my friends, is an important part of God's family history. We see the same in the New Testament. Let's think about the Apostle Paul, the greatest missionary of all time, the human author of vast portions of the New Testament, one of the top two theologians of all time, if not the top theologian of all time. You may know all of this about the Apostle Paul, but what you may not know is that Paul was an adoptive father. That's right. He adopted a child, at least in a way. That child's name was Timothy. Now, we know about Timothy from several books in the New Testament. Timothy's grandmother was Lois. Timothy's mother was Eunice. And Lois and Eunice were very diligent about nurturing the faith of young Timothy. Lois and Eunice are the exemplars of what it means to raise a child in the fear and knowledge of the Lord, as it says in the Bible. But as much as we know about Timothy's mother and grandmother, we know little, very little about Timothy's father. All that we know about him is that he was an unbeliever and absent from Timothy's life. So Timothy must have felt the pain of this absence. How could he not? But into that gap, into that void, steps the Apostle Paul. Paul acted as a father to Timothy. Paul was a mentor and a teacher and a friend. Timothy grew to be Paul's closest companion and most trusted co-worker. In fact, Timothy is listed as a co-author with Paul in many New Testament letters. Under Paul's guidance, Timothy became an able pastor. It was Paul's practice to go to a city or a region and plant a church. And then after a while, he would go to another city or another region and plant another church. But he wouldn't leave the first church alone and without help. No, he often appointed Timothy as pastor of the church in its next season of life. In the New Testament are two letters, 1 and 2 Timothy, which Paul wrote to his young protege with encouragement and advice. These are personal letters from one to another, and in them, Paul calls Timothy, and I quote, "My true child in the faith, my beloved child," or simply, "my child." Moreover, in Paul's letter to the Philippians, Paul is writing to them and talking about Timothy, and he says about him, "I have no one like him. As a son with a father, he has served with me in the gospel." And that about sums it up. Of course, the most obvious adoption in the Bible isn't the adoption of Moses or the adoption of Timothy. It's the adoption of Jesus. Yeah, Jesus. We all know the story. Joseph is engaged to a young woman named Mary, a virgin. Well, one day Mary turns up pregnant, and Joseph knows that she isn't pregnant by him. Well, before long, folks will see that Mary is pregnant, and they will wonder if it is by him or by another man, and whatever the answer, the situation isn't going to be good for anyone. And so it's perfectly understandable. It's perfectly reasonable how Joseph reacts. He decides to turn his back and walk away. That's what I would do. That's probably what you would do. Until an angel of the Lord appears to him and says, "What is conceived in Mary is from the Holy Spirit." And so Joseph decides to stay. Even though he has no legal obligation to the child, even though he has no moral obligation to the child, even though he has no genetic link to the child, he stays. And we have to think that at some point, maybe even on that first Christmas night, Joseph looked at the child and said, "This child is not from my body. This child is not mine, yet I make him mine. I accept him. I claim him and take him into my heart and home. A father I will be to him, and a son he will be to me." You see, my friends, adoption is an important part of God's family history. Moses the prophet, Timothy the saint, Jesus the Christ, all of them are adopted. But friends, this sermon isn't about Moses and his adoption, and it's not about Timothy and his adoption, and it's not even about Jesus and his adoption. No, this sermon is about you. It's about you and your adoption. You may not know this, you may not realize this, but all persons who are in Christ are adopted into the family of God. It's true. This may come as a surprise to you, just like Isaiah came as a surprise to me, but all persons who are in Christ are adopted into the family of God. Let me explain. The Bible uses many different metaphors to describe the relationship between God and humankind. For example, the relationship between God and humankind is sometimes described as the relationship between a king and a subject. At other times, it's described as the relationship between a shepherd and a sheep. At other times still, it's described as the relationship between a judge and a defendant. Each of these metaphors has value, because each one tells us something different and something important about God and us. But maybe the sweetest metaphor of all, maybe the sweetest metaphor of all is the metaphor of parent and child, specifically adoptive parent to adopted child. The Apostle Paul uses this metaphor five times in three of his most prominent letters, Romans, Galatians, and Ephesians. Indeed, adoption is one of the hallmarks of Pauline theology, and as we've said, Paul is one of the top two theologians of all time, maybe the top theologian. So friends, think with me for a moment. Why is adoption such an important theological concept? Why is adoption such an important theological concept? Well, I think the author J.I. Packer says it so well. He puts it perfectly. Listen, adoption is the highest blessing of the gospel, higher even than justification, because of the richer relationship with God that it involves. Justification is a forensic idea. It conceives of things in terms of the law and views God as judge. But adoption is a family idea. It conceives of things in terms of love and views God as father. In adoption, God takes us into his family and fellowship and establishes us as his children and heirs. Closeness, affection, intimacy, and generosity are at the heart of this relationship. To be right with God the judge is a great thing indeed, but to be loved and cared for by God the Father is even greater. In today's scripture lesson, Paul is speaking about the great plan of God, and true to form, he brings up adoption. He uses adoption as a metaphor. You know, when an adoption is complete, at that very moment, the adoptee has a new family. But not just a new family, the adoptee has a whole new reality, a whole new world, a whole new life. Everything is different. In the ancient world where adult adoptions were common, the adoptee was actually considered a new person, so new that it was like he was born again. So new was he that all records and claims and debts previously associated with him were treated like they never, ever existed. And so sure was his place in the new family that he had all the rights and all the privileges of a natural born son. Adoption transferred a person from one state to another. It wiped out the old and made new. And that, my friends, is what Paul says that God does for us. This is what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. And that is what April and I dreamed of doing for another person. April and I wanted to give a person the help and the home and the hope that they lacked. We wanted to give a person a new family, a new world, a new life, a whole new reality. We wanted to adopt, not because we thought it was just a good thing to do, but because we thought it was a God thing to do. Because it was something that God had done for us and that we wanted to do for someone else. And I ask you today, my friends, might this be something that you are called to do as well? I do not know. I truly do not know, but I invite you to pray about it, to search the scriptures, to look at the world, and to look into your heart, and to pray about it. So, sisters and brothers in Christ, let me close with this good news. Long ago, even before the creation of the world, God made a family plan, and that plan included you. God's plan was to bring you into his family and grace you with the same standing as a natural-born son, his only begotten son, Jesus the Christ. God's plan was to grant you the same rights and privileges before the Father, the same rights and privileges enjoyed by Jesus, the firstborn of all creation. God's plan was to make you co-heirs with Christ, to give you a greater inheritance than you could ever possibly imagine, the riches of God's glorious grace in the new heavens and the new earth. God's plan was to give you a beautiful, colorful, diverse family of many brothers and sisters, the faithful across all time and space, to give you a permanent place in God's home and a permanent seat at God's table. God's plan was to shower you with love and affection until the end of time, indeed beyond the end of time. Thanks be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the adoptive Father of all who are in him. Amen. Friends, let us continue to praise God with hymn number 59, "This is my Father's world." But before we do that, let us affirm to I believe that Jesus is the Christ.